In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Do you like to study the subject of grace? I don't know any preacher that does not enjoy preaching about the subject of the love of God. I don't know any preacher that doesn't enjoy preaching about something like that. But there are other things that we don't enjoy preaching about so much. And preachers, by the way, you can't get any angel to preach to you. They haven't been given the job of preaching. The job of a preacher has been given to human beings, so you can't get in. Human beings, of course, are sinners, just like you. So there's no angels that you can get, and these preachers are human, and they have human tendencies, and so they're just a natural tendency to preach more about things that you enjoy to preach about and to preach less about things that you don't enjoy preaching. Does that make sense to you? Is that the way human beings operate? And the problem is, the result of that can be that there are some things that are important to understand and know that God's people don't know very much about because nobody talks about it. And so I want to preach about one of those subjects today. And I don't enjoy preaching about these things any more than anybody else. But as I've thought about it, I said, I have a moral obligation to preach about this because God's people need to understand it. But I'm well aware of the fact that the subject I'm going to study with you is very sensitive and that people could misunderstand and I could be criticized for all sorts of things of saying I shouldn't say. But I think I need to talk about it even though it's dangerous to talk about. So I want you to kneel down and let's pray together that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, we thank you for the instruction you give us in the Bible that covers every area of life that we need to study and understand. And we earnestly pray that you will be our teacher, that the Holy Spirit may teach us the truth as we study together now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. To introduce the subject, and when I introduce the subject, you say, what's dangerous about that? Well, you'll find out. Introduce the subject, let's go to our scripture reading this morning in Romans, the 12th chapter. Romans, the 12th chapter. And as Christians, we are part of the body of Christ. The church is the body of Christ. Paul states that many times in his letters. He states it in the letter to the Ephesians. He states it in the letter to the Colossians. He also states that in this chapter. Let's look here in Romans 12, verses 4 and 5. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we being many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. Now, this is a very interesting subject to study. There are many members in the body, there are many members in the church, and they don't all have the same function. And God doesn't expect them to have the same function because they do different things. God does not expect the eye to do what the ear is supposed to do. And so, in the church, we have many members. They don't all have the same duty. They all don't have the same function. But we're all part of the same body. And then he goes on, we read it in our scripture, verses 6 to 8. He describes certain spiritual gifts that the Holy Spirit gives to this person or that person. Not everybody receives every spiritual gift. Now, if you want a more full description, a more detailed description, he gives a more detailed description of these spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. We're not going there today. And he talks about many different gifts. For example, one of the gifts, he mentions it here, is the gift of prophecy. Now, is everybody a prophet? No, not everybody's a prophet, but there are people in the church that have the gift of prophecy. And then he talks, for instance, about the gift of healing. Does everybody in the church have the gift of healing? Well, no. Different people in the church have different gifts. That the Holy Spirit decides which gifts, the gift of which. However, there are some things that the Holy Spirit wants to give to every person in the church. There are some gifts that the Holy Spirit wants to give to every person in the church. And what are these? Well, if you paid careful attention during our scripture reading today, in verses 9 to 21, he mentions approximately 30. He mentions approximately 30 different things that should characterize every person in the church. Well, obviously we can't go over 30 things. So we're just going to look at one. And if you go down to verse 13, obviously you could preach 30 sermons from this passage. We're just going to look at one today, just one. Verse 13, this is how every Christian in the church is supposed to have this. It says, given to hospitality. Given to hospitality. Let me ask you a question. When you get to heaven, are you going to practice hospitality? Are people in heaven, is everybody in heaven going to practice hospitality? Well, guess what? If you are going to practice hospitality in heaven, you're going to learn it down here. I want to read a couple of statements from the book Christ Object Lessons has to do with hospitality. Christ Object Lessons, this is a chapter on the talents. Christ Object Lessons, page 328. It says, the special gifts of the Spirit are not the only talents presented in the parable. It includes, now listen, it includes all gifts and endowments, whether original or acquired, natural or spiritual. All are to be employed in Christ's service. In becoming His disciples, we surrender ourselves to Him with all that we are and have. These gifts He returns to us, purified and ennobled, to be used for His glory in blessing our fellow men. That's page 328. Here's another statement about these things. Page 352, same chapter. It says, kindly affections, generous impulses, and a quick apprehension of spiritual things are precious talents and lay their possessor under a weighty responsibility. All are to be used in God's service. He goes on to say, those who possess large affections are under obligation to God to bestow them, not merely on their friends, but on all who need their help. Social advantages are talents and are to be used for the benefit of all within reach of our influence. The love that gives kindness to only a few is not love, but selfishness. So, hospitality, given to hospitality. In your Bible, there is recorded only 7 times during the entire biblical record, there is only recorded 7 times when somebody died and God saw fit to raise that person up from the dead again. Now, as you go over these different instances, there are, of the 7 times, there are 3 times when we don't really know anything about this person that was raised from the dead. We don't know that much about them. For example, a Eutychus that fell out the window when Paul was preaching, we really don't know anything about him. All we know is that Paul was preaching late at night and he got sleeping, went to sleep and fell out from the third story and was dead, and Paul went down and prayed for him and the Lord raised him back to life. So we don't know anything about him, his character or personality. Another one that we really don't know anything about is the only son of this widow of Nain who died, and Jesus met them coming out. They were on the way to the burial, and Jesus met them, and he comes up to the mother, the widow, and he says, "Don't weep." He goes over to the boy, and he says, "Young man, I say unto you, arise." And he arose. Now, we don't know anything about that young man, either before that or after that. We don't know anything about it, about him. And then there's a third one that we don't know anything about. This was shortly after Elisha died, and they were bringing a man to bury him. This man had died. They were bringing a man to bury him, and they saw a band of raiders coming, and they got scared. They said, just get him quickly, getting put somewhere and getting so we can flee. So they put him down in Elisha's grave, and do you know what the Bible says? When they let him down in Elisha's grave, as soon as he touched Elisha's well, bang, he rose back to life again. We don't know anything about that person. We don't know his name, anything about him. Those are three times when somebody was raised from the dead that we don't know anything about them. However, the other four times, this is interesting. The four times in the Bible that somebody was raised from the dead and we know something about them, every single time it was somebody, their family, that was given to hospitality. Interesting. Somebody given to hospitality. So I studied that and I said to myself, is showing hospitality important to God? In heaven, by the way, one of the great pleasures and joys of heaven is going to be giving and receiving hospitality from different people. But if we're going to do it there, we're going to learn it here. Well, there's a problem, though. Giving hospitality requires discrimination and good judgment, because there is righteous hospitality and there is evil or wicked hospitality. Hospitality can be either good or bad. Do you know the difference? Let's study just for a few minutes about the wrong kind of hospitality. My father was a person who was given to hospitality. If you knew him, you knew that when I was a child, and they didn't have church dinners at the church I went to when I was a child. I don't ever remember going one ever. But nobody ever came and visited our church and had to go home, didn't get invited. My father saw that they got invited to our house for dinner, whoever it was, preachers, anybody, the strangers. If they came to church, they didn't have to just leave and go and eat in the park or somewhere. Somebody was visiting. My father saw that they got invitations. And one time, I was already married when this happened. One time, my parents, there was a family, and I don't know what their economic or situation was, but they were in difficult circumstances. They had a trailer house that they could pull with a pickup, and my parents felt sorry for them because they were in a difficult financial situation, and so to help them through that difficult financial situation, my parents had some property, and they said, "Well, you can come and park your trailer right over here at our place until you can get this problem straightened out." And so they came and parked the trailer at my parents' property. Well, guess what? They seemed to assume that they could just stay there for the rest of their life. And the time came and my parents said, "Well, you know, we hadn't thought that they were going to be here for indefinitely. We were just trying to help them out." And they were Adventists. A very, very difficult situation to try to resolve. And This is one of the reasons that there is not as much hospitality as there would otherwise be, is because there are people in the world that when you try to be hospitable, they take advantage of it. And so you invite them over to your house for dinner, and then they stay all afternoon, and then they stay till evening, and it's past time your bedtime because you got to go to work tomorrow, and they're still there. And then you say, well, now what do I do? Shall I ask them to leave, or what shall I do? And let me read you something in the Bible about this. They had this problem in the Bible, so the Bible discusses it, and we need to understand it so that we know what to do and what not to do. And we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn those who are unruly, comfort the faint-hearted, uphold the weak, be patient with all. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good both for yourselves and for all. All right, and then he goes on to say, verse 21 and 22, test all things, hold fast what is good, abstain from every form of evil. Now, what is this abstaining from every form of evil, and what is it? Why should you have to test all things, and what is he talking about when he talks about those that are unruly? Well, that's why I got mixed up. This is in both 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians. In 2 Thessalonians, he explains more in detail what he's talking about here. So we're going to go to 2 Thessalonians now, where he's going to explain it more in detail. Look at verse 6, chapter 3, starting verse 6. We command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this is strong language. He says, I'm commanding you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is pretty strong. What am I not supposed to do? What am I supposed to do here? That you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly, and not according to the tradition which he received from us. Who are these people that are walking disorderly? And they're not supposed to have anything to do with them. They're supposed to withdraw from them. Just let them be. Don't fellowship with them. Don't extend hospitality to them. Who are these people? For you yourselves know how you ought to follow us. For we were not disorderly among you, nor did we eat anyone's bread free of charge, but worked with labor and toil night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you. Verse 9, not because we do not have authority, but to make ourselves an example of how you should follow us. For even when we were with you, we commanded you this, that if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. You know, friends, there are times we get calls. People say, you have this apartment over here, we know somebody, we got a call just a few days ago. Oh, so-and-so brother, he just got out of prison, he needs a place to stay, and could you just, we said, no, we know this person. We will not give him a place to stay. If we will not extend hospitality to him in that way, why? Because we know about this person, and we know that if we extend him a place to stay, once he gets over here, we'll never be able to get him out. Extending hospitality does not mean that you have the authority to go and live at somebody else's house at their expense. It doesn't mean that. That is not what it's talking about. In fact, Paul says, don't have anything to do with people that have that kind of a mindset. The Bible doesn't teach that. Because I'm a Christian, I'm not to think that I can go and just live at your place and you can support me and feed me and give me shelter, whatever. That's not Christianity. In fact, Paul said, don't have anything to do with people that think that way. I know that's strong, but that's in the Bible. He says, for we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. Now those who are such, we command and exhort through our Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread. As for you, brethren, do not grow weary in doing good. And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note that person and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. That's strong language, but that's in the Bible. So, the first kind of wrong kind of hospitality is the idea that, well, you're a Christian and I'm a Christian and you have a lot more money than I do and you're a lot better off than I, so you can just help me and I can just live at your place and you can... No. That's not Christianity. In fact, not only is it not Christianity, it's just opposed to Christianity. And Paul says, if anybody thinks that way, don't have anything to do with them. Just withdraw yourself from that person. Don't have anything to do with them. That's not the right kind of hospitality. The person who decides to stay living at your house and make that their permanent residence and let you support them and so forth, that is not what hospitality is about. There's nothing Christian about that. Here's number two. That was number one. Here is a second kind of hospitality that is not good. And we have this problem everywhere we go. We have it in this church. We have it everywhere we go, all over the country. We get into situations where there's some man that he's in economic trouble right now and he just needs a place to stay. He's got a job and he just needs a little help to get a place to stay. And he finds out there's a woman in the church that has a spare bedroom in her house that she's not even using. He says, well, could I rent that room from you till I can get on my feet? And she should say no immediately, but they don't. If you are a woman living alone, you should never be providing housing, providing a room in your house for some man to live there. It has the appearance of evil. You should never do that. It's very dangerous. The same way if you're a man and you're living alone, you should never be providing a bedroom for some woman to rent to stay in your house. That has the appearance of evil. You should never get involved in anything like that. And yet people do it all the time. They don't seem to understand that by doing this, they have the great potential of damaging the reputation of the entire church where they're going. Well, I won't spend a lot more time on that. That's a second one. Here's a third type of wrong hospitality. Sometimes when people try to be hospitable, they develop a situation where there is undue familiarity with different people. My dear friends, this is so much more serious than people realize that we just have to spend a little bit of time talking about this. I want to, first of all, go to the right to the Bible. The Bible discusses this in detail. This can exist not just among friends in the church, but it can exist right in your family. Let's see what the Bible says about this, about undue familiarity. Look in your Bible in Leviticus 18. Now, we don't like to read this in church. We're going to. Leviticus 18. Starting with verse 3, down to verse 7. According to the doings of the land of Egypt where you dwell, you shall not do. And according to the doings of the land of Canaan where I am bringing you, you shall not do. Nor shall you walk in their ordinances. You shall observe my judgments and keep my ordinances. To walk in them, I am the Lord your God. You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, which if a man does, he shall live by them. I am the Lord. None of you shall approach anyone who is near of kin to him to uncover his nakedness. I am the Lord. The nakedness of your father or the nakedness of your mother you shall not uncover. She is your mother. You shall not uncover her nakedness. He goes into great detail. Let me ask you the question. Why do you believe that God saw that it was necessary to go into such great detail in this chapter? Because it's a serious problem. People didn't realize how serious this was. I've had people that consider themselves to be Seventh-day Adventists, part of the Revival and Reformation movement, tell me what happened in their home, what was going on in their home when they were growing up. And when they told me, I said to myself, didn't your parents read the Bible? Now, we live in a fast, corrupt age. And I want to read to you, this is a book. Maybe we should republish this book sometime. It's called A Solemn Appeal by James White. However, in this book, there's a lot of this book actually was written by Ellen White. And I want to read to you on page 56. I want to read you what Ellen White said about this problem in Solemn Appeal, page 55, 56. Here's what she said. Mothers, you cannot be too careful in preventing your children from learning low habits. It is easier to guard them from evil than for them to eradicate it after it is learned. Neighbors may permit their children to come to your house to spend the evening and night with your children. Okay, what are you supposed to do? Your neighbors, they've let their children come over to your house and stay overnight. Now notice what Ellen White says about this. Here is a trial and a choice for you to run the risk of offending your neighbors by sending their children to their own home, or gratify them and let them lodge with your children and thus expose them to be instructed in that knowledge which would be a lifelong curse to them. And then Ellen White says, now this is my own practice. Now notice what Ellen White's practice was. To save my children from being corrupted, I have not allowed them to sleep in the same bed nor in the same room with other boys, and have, as occasion has required, when traveling, made a scanty bed upon the floor for them rather than have them lodge with others. I have tried to keep them from associating with rough, rude boys, and I have presented inducements before them to make their employment at home cheerful and happy. By keeping their minds and hands occupied, they have had but little time or disposition to play in the street with other boys and obtain a street education. A misfortune which occurred when I was about 9 years old ruined my health. I looked upon this as a great calamity and murmured because of it. In a few years, I viewed the matter quite differently. I then looked upon it in the light of a blessing. Why did Ellen White say this accident? You know what happened to her when she was 9 years old? Another girl threw a rock, hit her in the nose. She lost so much blood. She was an invalid can never go back to school again. She says, I looked upon this as a blessing. Now, here's the question. Why did Ellen White look at an accident like that as a blessing to her? You know why? She's going to tell you. I regard it thus now, a blessing. Because of sickness, I was kept from society, which preserved me in blissful ignorance of the secret vices of the young. Because of my sickness, I was kept from associating with the other young girls. And as a result, I did not know about the vices that were going on in the world. Now, by the way, this is 150 years ago. It's over 150 years ago. You think the world's gotten any better since then or worse? Which? He goes on to say, after I was a mother, by the private deathbed confessions of some females who had completed the work of ruin, I first learned that such vices existed. My dear friends, these type of practices are not only common in the world, they're even practiced by some people in Laodicea. But God's people who are faithful and true to the spirit of prophecy in the Bible will not be involved in anything like this. These things are common in the world, but they're not part of God's program for your children or your young people. Let me tell you, Steps Life has a little experience in this. It used to be about 20 years ago or so or more, we used to have campouts for young people. And by the way, these were like teenage people, not children, teenagers, and some in their young 20s. And we had the boys, the men all in one place, and there would be an adult man with them, and there were the girls in another place, adult woman with them. Guess what? We had so much trouble because we live in a world where hormones hit and the boys are girl crazy and the girls are boy crazy and you've got adults with them, but we had so much trouble, we said, we're not going to do this anymore. It could have been a blessing to the young people, but we said, we're not going to do it anymore. Just too dangerous. So that is another wrong kind of hospitality where you have undue familiarity. There's nothing godly about that, friends. You have children, you do not want those children sleeping at somebody else's house, and you do not want other children sleeping at your house with your children. Even if they're in separate beds in the same room, you don't want that. It's dangerous. Here's a fourth kind of wrong hospitality. It's what I call, and it's very prevalent in our society. I call it the entitlement mentality, and it's very common among the young. The entitlement is the idea that a lot of people have that either the church or the government or their parents or somebody owes them a living. Friends, I don't want to break your bubble, but if there's somebody here that's mixed up on this, you need to know that your parents don't owe you a living, and the government doesn't owe you a living, and the church doesn't owe you a living. We read it out of the Bible. You are to work and provide your own sustenance. We have that problem. People think that they're entitled to something, so you try to extend hospitality to them when they're in trouble, and they just take advantage of it because they think, well, they deserve it from you. And I want to mention at last, I didn't want to spend this much time on this, but this is the last one. Last form problem with wrong hospitality. I'll state this one very briefly. By the way, if every Adventist practiced the principles we've been talking about, the preachers all over the country would not have anywhere near as much work to do as they do. What we're talking about gets people in trouble. Here's a fifth problem. I'll just tell you. A man should not be having long conversations with a woman, especially alone, but even in public. A man should not be having long conversations with a woman, another man's wife. A woman should not be having long conversations with a man, somebody else's husband, even in public. And when this happens, and you go and talk to the people, we've had this happen in our church. When this happens and you go talk to the people, they say, we're not doing anything wrong. Oh? Well, guess what? 3 or 4 years down the line, the marriage breaks up. Well, let's talk about something a little bit different. Let's talk about special temptations and problems of those that are trying to show hospitality. Now, in the Bible, I just mentioned from the people that raised from the dead, just before the crucifixion, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And Lazarus and Martha and Mary were three people that had the gift of hospitality and extended hospitality. And around Jerusalem, there were thousands of Jews, and there are thousands of homes around there. And the King of Glory had come to this world, and he was in this world as a homeless wanderer. Ellen White says that often Jesus slept outside on the ground. I shudder when I think about it. And there were people all over that could have invited him over to give him a bed for the night. And there were thousands around Jerusalem that could have offered him a place to stay while he was there, and they missed the chance. And by the way, this is a subject you and I need to study. Let me tell you something that you maybe won't enjoy hearing. When you get to heaven during the millennium, you will be able to see every opportunity that God gave you in this world to extend hospitality to somebody, and you didn't take it. You'll be able to see everyone that you had an opportunity and you didn't take it. There were thousands of people around Jerusalem that had an opportunity to extend hospitality to Jesus. There was just one home that did. where Lazarus and Martha and Mary lived. And that's why, and Lazarus, of course, he was the head of the house. He was the brother. Martha and Mary's two sisters, they lived together, sister and two brothers, and they extended hospitality to Jesus. And no doubt, there's no question that this happened, that Lazarus had a talk with Jesus early in his ministry. And Lazarus said to Jesus, he said, look, anytime you're in the Jerusalem area, just come and stay at my place. You know what? Jesus did it. Ellen White says, and she talks about in Desire of Ages, when he came to Jerusalem, it says, as his custom was, he stayed in Bethany. What does that mean? Whenever he's in Jerusalem, he knew that Lazarus had a room where he could stay. He didn't need to sleep outside tonight. He could go to Lazarus' place. And so that's when Lazarus got sick. The sister sent to Jesus and said, the one that you love is sick. Ellen White comments about this. She says, Jesus loves every member of the human family. But, she says, there are some to whom he is linked by peculiar and tender associations. And Lazarus is one of these people. By the way, when you get to heaven, throughout all eternity, you're going to know, and everybody's going to know Lazarus. He's the one that when Jesus sojourned among the men as a homeless, he's the one that offers the hospitality to Jesus. He's the one. He will be known throughout all eternity as the special friend of Jesus Christ. You know what? Jesus might have some plans for you to have some special friends throughout eternity through your extending of hospitality to somebody down here. Well, we're not done, even though our time's about out. People that extend hospitality to others sometimes have special temptations. And Martha, I want to read you about Martha. Martha was a person that extended hospitality just as well as Lazarus. And when Jesus came to stay at their place, Martha always saw that Jesus had good food to eat. Martha was a pusher and a driver. And I've often thought, in any church, if you don't have a few people like Peter and John and Martha, you're not going to get much done. But if you have a few people like Peter and John, you know, something's going to happen. These people are going to make something happen. And Martha was one of those kind of people. And Ellen White said, we need the Marthas in the church. Any church that doesn't have a Martha in church is not going to accomplish much. However, in Desire of Ages, page 525, it says, the one thing that Martha needed was a calm devotional spirit, a deeper anxiety for knowledge concerning the future immortal life and the graces necessary for spiritual advancement. She needed less anxiety for the things which pass away and more for those things which endure forever. Martha was so busy doing the work of the Lord, she was fixing food for Jesus Christ. She was so busy working for the Lord, she didn't have enough time to spend with the Lord of the work. She says she needed to have more of a devotional spirit, to have more time to think about not just providing the food, the clothing, what was necessary to make the work go forward so that people have a place to stay, so they have clean clothing and good food and all those things. That's good. That has to be done. She was concentrating so much on making all those things happen that she didn't have time to meditate and spend half time with the Lord. Mary, the other sister, she had a problem every bit as serious, maybe more serious. Mary was an opposite temperament than Martha. And Mary was just like Lazarus. She was a friendly person. She extended hospitality to people. And people that are friendly, that extend hospitality, they can be subject to special temptations more than other people. And Mary was a person that was friendly and extended hospitality to other people. And she had a friend in the church. And he was a church leader. And his name was Simon. He was a friend of Mary's. And he was a leader. He was a Pharisee, so he was a leader in the church. And Simon, this friend of hers, got her into deep trouble. Let me read you what Ellen White says about this. It's in Desire of Ages, page 566. Now, this is the chapter where it's talking about the feast at Simon's house. Mary has just anointed the Lord with ointment. The aroma spread throughout the house. Judas starts criticizing, saying, "Why was this sold for 3,300 pence and given to the poor?" And Simon says to himself, if this man was a prophet, he would discern who this woman is, that she's a sinner, and he would not allow her to touch him. Jesus said to Simon, "I have something to say to you." You can read the whole story. We're out of time. You can read the whole story in Luke, the 7th chapter. Jesus showed Simon that as bad a sinner as Mary was, that he was a worse sinner than she was. Was he a worse sinner than Mary was? Let me read to you what Ellen White says about it. Desire of Ages, 566. Simon had led into sin the woman he now despised. She had been deeply wronged by him. We have much material to cover yet, and I'm going to go fast. So, you ready? Simon had led Mary into sin. She had been deeply wronged with him. So, now I have a question for you. Now, remember, he was a church leader. You need to understand this in case you get into a situation like this sometime. How does a church leader, or how does somebody lead somebody else into sin? You need to understand how this happens. So you know what to do if somebody starts trying to lead you into sin. Here we go. Number one. One of the principal ways that people are led into sin is by undue familiarity between men and women. We've already touched on that. Undue familiarity between men and women, between boys and girls and young people. We need to be friendly. We need to show hospitality. But we should not engage in undue familiarity. If you do, you will totally destroy your ability to witness for the church, for the Lord, and you will ruin the reputation of your church at the same time. Undue familiarity. Do you know that Ellen White wrote to ministers one time? You know, it's customary. I've done it all my life. All my adult life. It's customary at the church. The minister stands at the door and people come out and shake hands. I will shake the hand of a woman, and that is all. I have a custom, by the way. I started doing this a long time ago. I carry a Bible or something in my other hand so the woman sees that I only have one hand. That's all I got. Yeah, I'm not going to use the other hand. You know, one hand. And do you know what Ellen White wrote to ministers? She says, if a woman hangs on to your hand too long, you get your hand free, so you save her from sin. Is there a problem with undue familiarity because you're holding on to somebody too long? Yes, there is. Undue familiarity is a huge problem in our society. And some people don't even recognize it's a problem. Then they wonder why they get in trouble. Now, number one, we don't have a lot of time. Here we go quickly. Number two, a second way that people are led into the sin is by going together or taking a person to sports events and movies. It's the second way. We don't have time to develop it and explain how it happens, but that's how it happens. Here's a third way. Dancing and card playing. Any activity that will bring men and women together so that they're having physical contact is wrong. Number four, fourth way, use of the wine cup and narcotics. Fifth way, people are led into sin, by joking. You don't have time to develop that one either. It's dangerous. Joking. Some people are joking all the time. That's dangerous. A sixth way, by immodest dress. Immodest dress. That's another way that people are led into sin. A seventh way. The seventh way is when people, they're not married, they're just friends, but they spend a lot of time together, especially if they spend a lot of time together alone. Actually, it doesn't have to be always alone. Have you ever, I've noticed this for decades. I used to ask myself, how is it that physicians divorce their wife and they go marry their office nurse? Why do physicians do that? Well, they're spending 6 or 7 hours a day with their office nurse. They're only spending 2 or 3 hours a day with their wife, and they're awake. Why is it? I've seen this happen over and over. That executives divorce their wife and marry their secretary. Well, they're spending way more time in the day with the secretary than the wife. It's dangerous to be in a situation where you're a man or a woman talking to somebody with the office is at for a long period of time. That should not happen. Don't get yourself in a situation like that. What was the result? The result, my friend, was Simon was so successful in leading Mary into sin. I don't know all what approaches he used. And he got out. He walked out. Nobody thought anything. He'd done anything wrong. They didn't realize. And that's often the way it is. The person that gets somebody else in trouble, people don't even realize. In God's sight, they're the one that's most guilty. Nobody thought he was guilty. He was an upright person in the church. She was the one that was, and he despised her because of the mess she got in. And it was so bad. Mary got into such a terrible situation that her mind, this is what goes along with fornication and adultery over and over again. Your mind comes under the control of an evil spirit. Her mind was under the control of an evil spirit. But when Jesus came, Jesus prayed for her and rebuked the evil spirit and set her free. And guess what happened? I had a teacher in college, and he's talking to people praying to be ministers, and he said, listen, he says, you need to understand that when people get involved in any kind of sexual sins, that those are the most difficult sins to handle and get over and overcome and get away from. The most difficult. You need to understand that. And Mary fell into the same thing again? The second time Jesus came, and he rebuked the evil spirit and set her free. Read it yourself in Desire of Ages, page 568. Ellen White says that this happened 7 times. She fell back in, and Jesus came and set her free. My friend, if you've fallen into some kind of a sin problem and you don't know how to get free, you'll never set yourself free. But Jesus can set you free. If you're willing to surrender all to him, say, Lord, I'm all messed up. Mary was in such a bad condition. She was at the point of despair. She could easily have committed suicide. And Jesus came and said, you don't need to commit suicide. I can save you. I want to read you what Ellen White says about it happened with Mary. But I've often thought about this. Mary would not be allowed to be in any of our churches today. I know what would happen. People would not allow it. But I'll tell you something. She was one of the leaders of the early Christian church. Let me read you something. It says, the one who had fallen and whose mind had been a habitation of demons was brought very near to the Savior in fellowship and ministry. It was Mary who sat at his feet and learned of him. It was Mary who poured upon his head the precious anointing oil and bathed his feet with her tears. Mary stood beside the cross and followed him to the sepulcher. Mary was first at the tomb after his resurrection. It was Mary who first proclaimed a risen Savior. Who was the first person that preached to the world that Jesus Christ was a risen Savior? Who was it? It was Mary. And I want to tell you, friend, if you are saved, you're going to see someday in heaven a multitude of people with Mary at the head of a huge group of people that are going to say to you, we were the chief of sinners. We were considered the most awful, sinful people in society, but the Lord saved us, and we're here. My dear friend, whatever your situation is, if because you tried to be hospitable and friendly and extend hospitality, you got in trouble, the devil tripped you up, the Lord can still save you. He can set you free. He can make you over. He can give you a new heart and a new mind. And that's what the Christian religion is about. In the Christian religion, we believe that we're all lost and that none of us can save ourselves. And that none of us can give ourselves a new heart or new spirit, but God has promised through Jesus, I will give you a new heart. I will give you a new spirit. I'll make you over again. I will make you, when I make you over again, you'll be the same as if you had never got messed up. You want that to happen in your life? You want God to make you over again? And so you'll be the same as if you had never sinned. Would you like that to happen in your life? I want that to happen in my life. Let's pray about it before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we thank you that when we were ruined, that you figured out a way to deliver us from our degradation and guilt and sin, and set us free and make us over again so that we will be the same as if we had never done those things. And Lord, we choose to surrender ourselves to you now. We pray that you will give us every correction, every rebuke, every reproof that we need so that as we respond in obedience to your command that we can be changed and made new by the Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way. In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
For a number of years, I have thought it would be a wonderful thing if sometime I could preach a series of sermons on the book of Colossians. However, there are so many things that God's people need instruction about today. And I don't know if that'll ever happen, but today maybe we could study a couple of verses. Colossians, as you know, is a prison epistle. There are seven books in the New Testament that were written from prison. Six of those books that were written from prison were written by the Apostle Paul, and one was written by the Apostle John. The Apostle John was not in a prison of wood or stone. He was in an island prison as an exile on the Isle of Patmos. So there are seven books in the New Testament that are written from a prison, and these books are some of the most powerful books of the whole New Testament. And so I would like to study with you a couple of verses from the book of Colossians today. But before we begin, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, as we open your holy book to study it, we cannot comprehend how out of the dark places of the earth, out of prisons and dungeons, you can bring such marvelous light to your people. But we pray that as we read and as we study, that your Holy Spirit may be our teacher and help us to understand that you are always able to bring light out of darkness. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. The book of Colossians is a companion epistle to the book of Ephesians. However, there are a lot of similarities between the two books, but they are also very different, because if you study the book of Ephesians carefully, it appears that the church at Ephesus, and by the way, when that was written, the church of Ephesus was the leading church, the leading Christian church in all the world. And missionaries went out to all the world from the church at Ephesus. And it was from the church at Ephesus that missionaries went out and converted people and established the church at Colossae. And the book of Colossians is very different. Even though it is similar, it is also very different from the book of Ephesians, because the church at Colossae, was, well, either they were in the process, or probably more probable, they were already deceived. And they were believing quite a few false doctrines. And the Apostle Paul corrected these false doctrines that they had deceived them in this little book, this letter to the Colossians. And so we're just going to look. We can't look at all the different things he mentioned in the Colossians. I could outline very quickly half a dozen sermons from the book of, on the book of Colossians, but we're just going to look at two verses, and we read them in our scripture. If you have your Bible, I invite you to open it to Colossians 2. We'll start reading in verse 8. And there are several ways that this verb can be translated in the first part of verse 8. In the Bible version that Brother Steve was reading from a few minutes ago, the word was spoil. That's correct translation. In the version that I have in front of me, the word they used is cheat. I actually like the translation, however, that's in the margin. Here's the marginal reading. Beware lest anyone take you captive through philosophy. Let me ask you a question. Are people still being taken captive through philosophy today? Yes, they are. Are people being taken captive in the Seventh-day Adventist Church through philosophy today? Is philosophy wrong? No, philosophy itself is not wrong. Philosophy comes from two Greek words, which means to love wisdom. It's a person that loves. And so a philosopher is a person that he tries to reason things out. Now, there's nothing wrong with trying to reason things out, but the problem is, in trying to reason things out, we will get misled or deceived or go astray unless we are guided by God's Word. And that's the trouble with philosophy. Philosophers try to reason things out without being guided by God's Word. Philosophy is all right, as long as your philosophy, your philosophizing is guided by the Word of God. But notice the problem here. Beware lest anyone take you captive through philosophy and empty deceit according to the tradition of men. There's the problem with philosophy. So much philosophy, it's not according to the Word of God. It's not guided by the Word of God. It's according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world. It's worldly philosophy, not according to Christ. Now, the Apostle Paul would not have given them this warning unless they actually had a problem. The Apostle Paul would not have given them this warning if they didn't have a problem with being led astray with philosophy and false teaching. Well, what was the philosophy and what was the false teaching that was leading these people in this church astray right now? What is he talking? What is the context of this? Well, look at the next verse. We'll read them together. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. In him, in Christ, there dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So tell me, what was it that the people in this Colossian church, what was it that they were getting led astray upon? What was it? In general, they were getting led astray and deceived about the Godhead, and more specifically, they were getting led astray and deceived about the person and the character of the second person of the Godhead, about Jesus Christ. Are people still getting led astray concerning the Godhead? Well, the doctrine about God is one of the things that has been a focal point of the devil's attack against Christianity and against God's people ever since time began. This was a focal point of his attack with the angels in heaven when he deceived them. Let me read you just a paragraph about this from the book Great Controversy, page 569. This is what it says. It is Satan's constant effort to misrepresent the character of God. What is his constant effort? To misrepresent the character of God. And what else? The nature of sin. By the way, are Christians today confused about what sin is? They absolutely are. And the real issues at stake in the great controversy, his sophistry, Satan's sophistry, lessens the obligation of the divine law and gives men license to sin. At the same time, he causes them to cherish false conceptions of God so that they regard him with fear and hate rather than with love. The cruelty inherent in his own character is attributed to the Creator. It is embodied in the systems of religion and expressed in modes of worship. Thus, the minds of men are blinded, and Satan secures them as his agents to war against God. Have you ever met somebody that hates God? By perverted conceptions of the divine attributes, heathen nations were led to believe human sacrifices necessary to secure favor of deity. By the way, human sacrifices were not only practiced in Europe, in the Middle East, in Asia, in Africa. Human sacrifices in ancient times were practiced in North America and Inner America and South America. And if that was our subject today, I could demonstrate that. I could show you examples in North America, Central America, and South America, as well as in Africa and Asia, all over the world. Heathen religions practiced human sacrifices. By the way, there are still There are still religionists today in the United States that believe in human sacrifices. He says, horrible cruelties have been perpetuated under their various forms of idolatry. She goes on to say that the very same problem that existed in the heathen nations with cruelty as a result of lack of understanding of the character of God, the very same things has happened in the Roman Catholic Church. You can read that in the latter part of page 569. Some of the most dangerous deceptions that human beings can be involved in is when a person is taught false theories about God. For example, here is the way that Elder George Vandeman tried to describe this problem 35 years ago. I'll read in his book, Rise and Fall of the Antichrist. I'll read you just a little bit from page 21. Here's what he wrote. Auschwitz, Dachau, Ravensbrück, Nazi death camps. Without a doubt, the horror of modern history is the Holocaust. Hitler's massacre of innocent millions still staggers our understanding. Now, imagine, if you will, he says, God asking your advice on Judgment Day. He wants you to help him in deciding how to punish sinners. As you stand beside the great white throne, a man named Tom steps up to be judged. Years ago, he discovered his wife at a motel hideaway with another lover. In a fit of jealous rage, Tom shot them both. One rash act. Otherwise, he lived a decent life. What sentence should Tom receive? Next comes Karen, a shy teenager, trembling in fear and shame. She tearfully admits to shoplifting a camera from Kmart. How long should Karen suffer for her sin? And now you meet the mastermind of mass extermination, Hitler himself. Little question that this monster of more than 6 million murders deserves to burn in hell for a long time. Well, suppose God wants Hitler to burn forever for his incredible atrocities. You might understand that. But what if God also condemns Tom and Karen to suffer the same length of time, sentencing all their three to share eternity in the fire? No concern for their differing degrees of guilt. Does that sound fair? Well, you think it over. Do you understand, friends, that the doctrine of eternal hell has resulted in making millions of people infidels and atheists? Are you aware of that? People say, that's impossible. There couldn't be a God like that. So they forsake all belief in God. They've been taught the wrong theory about what God is like. They've been taught a falsehood about what God is like. And as a result, they say they don't believe in God at all. In the beginning of the Second Advent movement, the Advent pioneers understood how dangerous it was to have a false idea about God. They understood. They understood that the idea that God would burn people in hell forever was a dangerous deception and would result in infidelity and atheistic belief. The pioneer Adventists understood that the doctrine of the Trinity was not a Christian doctrine at all, but a teaching that came into the Christian church from paganism in the 4th century. Right here I have a book by Alexander Hislop called The Two Babylons. Let me read you a few sentences from pages 16 and 17. It says, in the unity of that only one God of the Babylonians, there were three persons. And to symbolize the doctrine of the Trinity, they employed, as the discoveries of Laird proved, the equilateral triangle. Notice The heathen nations of ancient time all over the world had a doctrine of the Trinity. They believed in a triune God. They believed that there was one God and three persons. Notice what it says, page 17. The papacy has in some of its churches, as for instance, in the monastery of the so-called Trinitarians of Madrid, an image of the triune God with three heads on one body. The Babylonians had something of the same. Mr. Leonard, in his last work, has given a specimen of such a triune divinity worshipped in ancient Assyria. In Japan, Buddhists worship their great divinity, Buddha, with three heads in the very same form under the name of Tsongpa. All these have existed from ancient times. While overlaid with idolatry, the recognition of a trinity was universal in all the nations of the world. This is page 19. While this had been the original way in which pagan idolatry had represented the triune God, and though this kind of representation had survived to Sennacherib's time, there is evidence that at a very early period, they developed this idea. So, the Adventist pioneers understood that the heresy of the doctrine of the Trinity, that is, the doctrine of a triune God, was not in the Bible. The Bible doesn't teach it. It's nowhere in the Bible. The God of the Bible teaches us that a non-Trinitarian view of God. Incidentally, the Roman Catholic Church, Roman Catholic theologians are very well aware of the fact that the Bible does not teach the doctrine of the Trinity. Let me read to you. If you want to read more on this subject, here's a book you can get called The Truth and the Trident. Let me read you a few sentences from page 20. Now, this is by Hans Kung, a famous Roman Catholic theologian. This is what he said. In Judaism, indeed, throughout the New Testament, while there is belief in God the Father, in Jesus the Son, and in God's Holy Spirit, there is no doctrine of one God in three persons. No doctrine of a triune God, a Trinity. Well, somebody might say, well, exactly what is the doctrine of the Trinity? I'll give you the doctrine of the Trinity in one sentence. The doctrine of the Trinity is the doctrine that, quote, within the one being called God, there exists three co-eternal, co-equal persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And as I mentioned, that doctrine is not found anywhere in the Bible. The Bible teaches just the opposite, as we're going to see in a few moments. Now, saying that, I am well aware that somebody might say to me, well, Pastor John, haven't you read 1 John 5:7? Well, yes, I have read 1 John 5:7. Let me read to you a little bit about 1 John 5:7. This is from the new text of the New Testament by Bruce Metzger. And here's what he says about 1 John 5:7. He has several pages in here about 1 John 5:7. I'm just going to read part of a paragraph. It says, the passage does not appear in manuscripts of the Latin Vulgate before about 800 A.D. In view of its inclusion in the Clementine edition of the Latin Vulgate that was published in 1592, in 1897, now get this, you've got the date? In 1897, the Holy Office in Rome, a high ecclesiastical congregation, made an authoritative pronouncement approved and confirmed by Pope Leo XIII that it is not safe to deny that this verse is an authentic part of St. John's epistle. That's 1 John 5:7. Now that's very interesting. that statement that was approved by the Pope in 1897 has put every single Roman Catholic scholar in the world in a very unenviable position, because if you know that that shouldn't be part of the Bible, that's a spurious text, but somebody that you have been taught ever since you were a child was infallible, said that it should be in the Bible, where do you go with that? Well, somebody says, how do you know? He goes on to show Roman Catholic scholars all say the same thing. Let me read you just a little bit about 1 John 5:7 from this little book called A Textual Commentary of the Greek New Testament. And I'll look at just a few sentences in here, pages 647 to 649. This is on 1 John 5:7. This is what it says. Number one, this passage, 1 John 5:7, is absent from every known Greek manuscript except 8, and these contain the passage in what appears to be a translation from a late recension of the Latin Vulgate. 4 of the 8 manuscripts contain the passage as a variant reading written in the margin. Well, what do you think about that? That's just the beginning. It's not in any Greek manuscripts. But here's number 2. Number 2. This passage is quoted by none of the Greek fathers, church fathers, who, had they known it, would most certainly have employed it in the Trinitarian controversies. That's in the 4th and 5th centuries. Its first appearance in Greek is in a Greek version of the Latin Acts of the Lateran Council in 1215. Yeah, that's a second point of evidence. It's a spurious text. Somebody added it. It was not written by the Apostle John. Here's a third point. Here's the third point of evidence. Number 3, the passage is absent from the manuscripts of all ancient versions of the New Testament. Now, my friends, the New Testament was translated in all the ancient languages of the world. It was translated into Syriac, Coptic, Armenian, Ethiopic, Arabic, Slavonic. It was copied into all those languages in ancient times, and not one of those ancient versions has that verse in there. Well, he has another, I think we won't read another 2 pages of evidence. He shows that why that there is no scholar in the world that believes, that I know of, that believes that that text should be in there. There's the evidence is against it. Well, if that's the case, and if that's the only text in the Bible that you could deduce for the teaching of the Trinity, well, then what do you have for teaching the Trinity in the Bible? You don't have a single text. 1 John 5:7 is the only text that you can use to teach the Trinity in the Bible. And remember, it says in Colossians 2:8, beware lest anyone take you captive by philosophy and vain deceit. Now, up until 1898, the majority of Adventists, they knew that the Trinity doctrine was false. And if you know that something is false, what do? You think, well, if that's false, what is the truth? And it's an interesting thing that happens in these complicated subjects. The Bible says that no man by searching can find out God. When you know that this isn't true, well, look at what happened in Jesus' day. In Jesus' day, the church was divided mainly into 2 factions, the Jewish church. The biggest group were the Pharisees. The smaller group were the Sadducees. And so, if you looked at things, as the average person looked at things, they say, well, let me think now. Is the Pharisees right or are the Sadducees right? And so, people looked at that and they tried to decide between the two. What was the problem? The problem was they're both wrong. And that's a problem in this case too. The majority of Adventists in the 19th century, recognizing that the doctrine of the Trinity was wrong, they went to on the other side. What's the alternative? They became what we call Arian. They had adopted the Arian view of the Godhead. up until 1898. And since that time, Adventism was in flux for some decades. But by the 1930s and the 1940s, some Adventist theologians had switched again and had become Trinitarian. And the pressure to conform to the Roman Catholic doctrine of the Trinity increased until finally, in 1980, in Dallas, Texas, the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference officially adopted the pagan doctrine of the triune God. It's not in the Bible. They put that apostate Trinity doctrine as part of the fundamental beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Today, we've gotten to the point where people who claim to be revival and reformation preachers are preaching and publishing books promoting the heretical doctrine of the Trinity. And at the same time, there has been a tremendous backlash in Adventism over the Trinity doctrine that became official by the General Conference in 1980. So there is a whole contingent of Adventist preachers all over the world who are preaching Arianism again. The idea that Arianism is the idea that sometime back in eternity, Christ was begotten by the Father. And in addition to that, Arians believe that the Holy Spirit is not a person, not a separate person. Actually, when you get to, if you're a theologian and you get to start to compare these two things, you actually start comparing Trinitarianism and Arianism, you'll find out something very interesting. They actually are very closely related teachings, but they're both wrong. The Bible does not teach Arianism, and the Bible does not teach Trinitarianism either. The idea that there is one God in three persons is totally contrary to the teaching of the Bible. Well, somebody says, Pastor John, haven't you read what the Bible says about there being one God? Well, yes, I have. Let's read what the Bible says about there being one God. Have your Bible? Open it to 1 Corinthians 8. 1 Corinthians 8. Read verse 4. Therefore, the concerning the eating of things offered to idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is no other God but one. So he says, we know that there is no other God but one. Now, this verse has been used by Adventist theologians in recent years to try to prove the doctrine of the Trinity. Friend, have you read the context? Let's read the context of verse 4. Let's go on reading. For even if there are so-called gods, whether in heaven or on earth, as there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is only one God in three persons. Is that what it says? Read your Bible. What does it say? For us, there is only one God, and who is that one God? Is it one God in three persons? It's one God, the Father. You see that in your Bible? So when Paul said in verse 4 that to us there is one God, who was he talking about? Was he talking about three persons? No, he was talking about the Father. He says, for us there is one God, who? The Father, of whom are all things, and we for him. And one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we live. Another verse that Adventist theologians have used to try to prove the Trinity in the New Testament is James 2. Let's go to James 2. James 2, verse 19. You believe that there is one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. Does this verse prove the Trinity? Well, not at all. It shows just the opposite if you look at the context. Look over to chapter 3, James 3, 9. When James says there's one God, who's he talking about? Listen, James 3, 9, with it we bless our God and Father. So when he talks about God, who's he talking about? He's talking about the Father. Now, there are many verses in the New Testament which say the same thing, that say there's one God, and this God is the Father. I've got, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I got 8 written down in addition to the ones we just read. We're not going to take time to read all 8. Look at 1. Look in the book of Ephesians. This is a very interesting passage in Ephesians 4. It says, we'll read verses 4 to 6. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So, when the Bible says that there is one God, who's it talking about? It's talking about the Father, every single time. Well, somebody says, Pastor John, haven't you read the verses in the Bible that refer to Jesus as God? Well, yes, I have. I could take time to read all of them to you right now. I read the verses in the Bible that where Jesus is addressed and called God, and he accepted worship. Are you aware of the fact, after the resurrection, have you read the verses in the Bible where when the disciples saw Jesus again, they knelt down and worshiped him, the women worshiped him, the men worshiped him, all the apostles worshiped him. And Thomas, when Thomas was convinced, Thomas says, I won't believe unless I see the nail prints of the nails in his hand and put my hand in his side and see where the spear appeared, I won't believe. And when Jesus appeared to him, he was so overwhelmed, he fell down and worshiped him, and he said, my Lord and my God. And Jesus accepted that. He didn't rebuke him. I'm aware of all those verses. Not only that, somebody else could say, well, haven't you read the verses in the Bible where God the Father is addressed as Lord? Now remember, in these verses we read, he said we have one God and we have one what? One Lord. And who is the one Lord? Jesus Christ. But have you read the verses in the Bible where God the Father is addressed and called the Lord? Have you read Psalm 110:1? God the Father is spoken of as the Lord. So there are a few verses in the Bible where Jesus is addressed as God, and there are some verses in the Bible where the Father is addressed as Lord. How do you explain that? Well, that's actually not really complicated. Let's make it a little more complicated, though, to make it easier to understand. Let's go back to Ephesians 4. You have Ephesians Bible open to Ephesians 4. It says, there is one body, and you see, there's verse 4. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Now, there are some very troubling things. There were some very troubling things to me in this verse when I started studying it. Because Paul says there is one Spirit. Now, wait a minute, Brother Paul. You yourself wrote in Hebrews 1, that all concerning all the angels, that they're ministering spirits, and there are billions of them. Not only that, but every human being has a spirit. Have you read about that in the Bible? There are several places that you could read about it. Look at the book of Zechariah. Zechariah, the 12th chapter, and verse 1. It says, the burden of the word of the Lord against Israel, thus says the Lord, who stretches out the heavens, lays the foundation of the earth, and forms the spirit of man within him. Every human being that's alive has a spirit. You have a spirit. James says, if you lose your spirit, then you're dead. You can read about that in both the Old and New Testament. They write about it. As long as you have your spirit, you're alive. But when you lose your spirit, you're dead. So every human being that's alive has a spirit. And the angels are spirit, and that's not all. God the Father is a spirit because Jesus said so. Let's read it. Look in the Gospel of John, the 4th chapter. Gospel of John, the 4th chapter, verse 24. Jesus is speaking to the woman at the well of Sychar, and he says, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. God the Father is a spirit. Jesus said so. Jesus was a spirit. He had one of the last things that Jesus said just before he died on the cross. You can read it in Luke 23, verse 46. He said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. So the Father has a spirit. Jesus has a spirit. The angels have spirits. Every human being that's alive has a spirit. So now let me ask you this question. Why then does the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 4 say there is one spirit? Why does he say that? Have you ever thought that through? Well, let's review. When the Bible writers say that there is one God, who are they talking about? They're talking about the Father. When the Bible writer says there is one Lord, who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus Christ. When a Bible writer says there's one Spirit, he's talking about the Holy Spirit. The Spirit is an official title for the Holy Spirit. And there is only one Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is separate from the Father and the Son because of this text here. Notice, the Holy Spirit is listed as one Spirit, and then the Lord and the Father are listed separately. Did you see that in the verse? That's verses 4 to 6, Ephesians 4. So, by the way, in your home, is it necessary when you refer to different members in your family? You know, I grew up in a home. My grandfather's name was John. My father's name was John. And my name is John. And my son's name is John. Do you think there's any chance that the people in our family figured out names to address each other so they kept those different people separate? Have you seen other families that do that? Well, the Bible writers, when they write to you about God, they want you to know what member of the Godhead they're talking about. And so you can think of the word God as an official title for the Father. And you can think of the word Lord as an official title for Jesus Christ. This will make the study of the Bible very interesting when you understand that. You can take the expression, the Spirit, or the Holy Spirit, as an official title for the Holy Spirit. But the Apostle Paul says, beware lest anybody take you captive by philosophy. I want to read to you, I want to spend the next few minutes, we only have a few minutes left, I want to spend the next few minutes studying with you a little bit about the second person of the Godhead, the Lord. Paul says we have one Lord. And he is, let's see what the Apostle Peter said about him, about Jesus. Look in Acts, the 10th chapter. Acts, the 10th chapter. And verse 36. This is Peter preaching to Cornelius, a Roman soldier. And he's telling the gospel. And this is what he says about Jesus in Acts 10:36. The word which God sent to the children of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. That's what he says. That's what Peter says. Jesus Christ is Lord of all. The Apostle Paul says the same thing in just as strong a language. Look in your Bible in Philippians 2. This is also a prison letter. Philippians 2, starting with verses 9 to 11. It says, therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Notice, he is Lord of all. Jesus Christ is Lord of all, and the day is coming. I can read to you when it's going to come in the book Great Controversy. The day is coming when every knee is going to bow of things in heaven and things on earth. Every knee is going to bow to the lordship of Jesus Christ. That day is coming. That's what Paul says here. He says, at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, or those of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. That day is coming. If both the loyal and the disloyal, both the lost and the saved, are going to kneel and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That day is coming. But now, if you understand that, I want to read to you and study with you for a few minutes, the last few minutes we have left, a very, very strange scripture. If you have your Bible, please open it to the book of Hosea. Hosea, the second chapter. Start reading in verse 16. Matt, that's probably the only verse we'll read, just verse 16. Hosea 2:16. And it shall be in that day, says the Lord. Who's speaking? The Lord. Is that what it says? Who is speaking? The Lord is speaking. Who is the Lord? Jesus Christ. I've studied this carefully for many years. In your Bible, most of the time, when the Bible uses the word Lord, it's talking about Jesus Christ. Most of the time. It's going to come to pass in that day, says the Lord. This is the Lord speaking. The one to whom every knee in heaven and earth is going to bow. And this is what he's going to say. Is it come to pass in that day that you will call me Ishi? You will no longer call me Bailey. Those are Hebrew words. Do you know what those words mean? Well, I'm going to tell you. Those words mean, you're going to call me my husband. You are no longer going to call me my husband. Did you know that? Both of those words mean my husband. Both of those words mean that. However, they're completely different words. So what is the Lord trying to tell us here? And Ishi was a husband A person that you are united to by a covenant of mutual affection. Is she? A person, a husband that you were united to by a covenant of mutual affection. And is she? Bailey was also a husband. But the word Bailey means somebody that is a master or ruler over you. Somebody that lords it over you and tells you what to do. And the Lord says, in that day, you're going to call me Ishi. You're not going to call me anymore Bailey. Oh, somebody says, Pastor John, you don't understand. There's really no difference, because you can read in the New Testament three times it says that women are to submit to their husbands. And in 1 Peter 3, it says that Sarah called Abraham Lord, so there's no difference. And the New Testament says over and over again, the woman is to be submissive to her husband. Well, you know what? You want me to drop a bombshell on you? If you're thinking that way, you don't yet understand the most fundamental truth about the God or the Godhead of the Christian religion. You see, friends, every text in the Bible has a context. And when you take the text out of context, it's not true anymore. God never intended that the husband would be a Bailey. God's not that way. Christ isn't that way. God never intended for human beings to be that way. That's all part of the devil's perversion. God never intended for a husband to be a Bailey. It's supposed to be an Ishi, but not a Bailey. You understand what that's about? Well, you'll have to think this through on your own. But in closing, I want to read to you a text, a passage of Scripture on this very subject. You'll have to think about this text maybe for a long time to get the full thrust of it. But this was a conversation that Jesus had with his disciples right after Peter and John came to him and their mother. And their mother had a special request. And their mother said she knew that Peter and John were the closest disciples of Jesus. Peter and John were part of the favored three who had been allowed to go with Jesus up to the Mount of Transfiguration. And they had seen him glorified as he will appear in the second coming. They had seen Moses and Elijah talking with him. They were Peter and James and John. They had had this privilege. The other disciples hadn't had that privilege. And this Zebedee's wife knew that James and John were two of Christ's closest disciples and companion, and she thought for them something would be appropriate that maybe wasn't appropriate for all the others. And so she said to Jesus, I have something to ask you. He says, what do you have to ask me? She says, would you grant that my two sons, this is James and John here, would you grant that my two sons could sit one on your right hand and the other on the left hand in your kingdom? In other words, I want them to be the number one in the number one and number two spot in the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus responded and he said, you don't know what you're asking. By the way, have you ever asked God something that you don't know what you're asking? Jesus said, you don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink of the cup that I'm going to drink of? Are you able to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They said, we're able. By the way, Ellen White says that if somebody had approached Peter and John when Jesus was
suffering in Gethsemane and asked them if they were able to drink the cup he was drinking and be baptized with the baptism, they wouldn't have said yes. They didn't know what they were talking about. They said, we're able.
Jesus said, you indeed are going to drink of the cup that I drink of, and you're going to be baptized with the baptism that I'm baptized with, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not for me to give. It'll be given by my Father, not me.
And then the ten other disciples, Peter and Judas and all the others, they heard about this conversation and they were really angry. Have you ever been in a church where something happened that one part of some of the church members got angry against the other? You ever seen that happen? They got angry. So they're about to have a big church split. It was a little tiny church, only about 12 people, and they were about to split up. So this is a conversation that Jesus had with them at that time. Turn your Bible to Matthew 20. When you think about the lordship of Jesus Christ, the fact that the day is coming that every knee is going to bow to him, every tongue is going to confess, this text will help you to understand how that's going to happen. Here's what it says. Starting with verse 25. Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them. Those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. My dear friend, to understand what the lordship of Jesus Christ involves and what it means, you need to read that passage. He said the Gentiles, they exercise lordship over each other. They lord it over each other. But it's not supposed to be that way among you. In my kingdom, whoever wants to be great, let him be a servant. Whoever desires to be first, let him be a bondservant. Who is number one in the kingdom? Who is the majesty of the kingdom of heaven? My dear friends, the person who is in first place. The Apostle Paul says that to Jesus Christ, he's going to have preeminence. He's going to have first place in everything. He mentions that in the first chapter of Colossians. He has first place. The person who has first place came to this world. And he went lower than any human being will be able to go to save you and to save me. The one who first must become lowly, must have the heart of a servant. My dear friend, if you and I are going to be in the kingdom of heaven, we are going to be converted so that we have a servant's heart, so that we serve one another instead of lording it over each other. If we don't learn that, my dear friend, we'll never be in the kingdom of heaven. Well, you study it yourself. Matthew 20, verses 25 to 28. Let's pray before we sing our closing song. Father in heaven, we pray that you'll help us that we may not serve the gods of this world or the lords of this world. Help us to be faithful to you and to the one Lord of all, to Jesus Christ. And we pray that we might each one receive the Holy Spirit so that we might be transformed in character to a reflection of the character of our divine Lord. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.